Today we're going to talk about the SIR model of an epidemic. First, let's review some ideas from before about the existence and uniqueness of systems of differential equations. We begin with a motivating question. Say that we have an initial value problem, dx dt equals f of txy, and dy dt equals g of txy, where x of t0 equals x0 and y of t0 equals y0. Before we look for methods on how to find the solution, capital Y of t, which is lowercase x of t and lowercase y of t, how do we know that one exists? This is the content of the existence and uniqueness theorem. Say that there exists a rectangle, which consists of t, x, and y, where t is between a and b, x is between c and d, and y is between p and q. Satisfying the following properties. First, each of f, the partial of f with respect to x, and the partial of f with respect to y are continuous in this rectangle. Second, each of g, the partial of g with respect to x, and the partial of g with respect to y are continuous. And third, the point t0, x0, y0 is also in this region. Then there exists an interval which consists of time t between t0 minus epsilon and t0 plus epsilon, such that the initial value problem has a unique solution defined for all time t in this interval. Now, let's go ahead and talk about the SIR model. This all begins with the Belgian mathematician Pierre Verhoost, who was interested in the following statement. The rate of change of the size of a population is proportional to the size of the population as well as its distance from the carrying capacity. Let's denote y of t as the size of said population at time t. Then dy dt is proportional to 1 minus y over m times y, where m is the carrying capacity. Verhoost called this the logistic growth model, although some people nowadays call this the Verhoost model. Simply put, if we let k be the constant of proportionality, then we can explicitly solve for this population size y of t, and here we've expressed it in two different ways, the one at the bottom in terms of the inflection time t, I, and f. Of course, this can all be generalized. Independently, the United States, the American physicist Alfred Lotka, and the Italian physicist Vito Volterra were interested in population sizes, and they arrived independently at a certain equation that now we'll describe. Let's let y of t denote the size of a population of predators at time t, and x of t denote the size of a population of prey at time t. In order to model these two populations, we'll make a few assumptions. First, as with logistic growth, the rate of change of each population is proportional to its size, and each population has a carrying capacity. Second, there exists a number n sub y such that if y is greater than n sub y, then the prey are hunted and their population decreases. However, if y is less than n sub y, then the predators cannot effectively hunt the prey and their population decreases. Third, there exists another size n sub x, such that if x is greater than n sub x, then the prey are numerous and the population of predators increases. But if x is less than n sub x, then the prey are hard to find and the population of the predators decreases. Putting all of this together, before we found the logistic Lotka-Volterra predator-prey model. It's a two-dimensional system of first-order equations. The idea is that we can express them as some type of a linear combination between a predator-prey model and a logistic growth model. We can express this modified predator-prey model in a slightly simpler form. Here, m sub x and m sub y are the carrying capacities, and alpha, beta, gamma, delta are just some constants of proportionality. Now, our motivating question for today is, what if we would like to model three populations? The story for today begins with the British medical doctor named Sir Arnold Ross. He was very interested in the spread of malaria in India. In 1897, he discovered that there is a parasite, typically called the Plasmodium falciparum, which is carried by a mosquito. People become infected with the parasite when bitten by the infected mosquitoes. In 1902, he received the Nobel Prize for Physiology for medicine, becoming the first British Nobel laureate. Ross then turned his attention to developing mathematical models for the study of malaria epidemiology. Let's back up for a moment. Epidemiology is the branch of medicine which deals with the incidence, distribution, and possible control of diseases and other factors relating to health. This word is derived from the Greek epi, meaning among, demos, meaning people, and logos, meaning study, suggesting that the word epidemiology means the study of what is among the people. Ross first began studying such mathematical models in 1908. There's a wonderful book which just came out a couple of years ago by Adam Gucharski called The Rules of Contagion. Let me read a section here that talks a little bit about Ross's ideas at the turn of the century. Ross proposed a theory of happenings to describe how the number of people affected by something, whether a disease or another event, might change over time. He suggested that there are two main types of happening. The first affects people independently. If it happens to you, it generally won't increase or decrease the chances of it happening to someone else afterwards. This could include things such as non-infectious diseases, accidents, or divorce. Things get more interesting when events are contagious. Ross calls such events dependent happenings because what happens to one person depends on how many others are currently affected. Ross really wasn't a mathematician, so he sought the help of a mathematics professor in coming up with some of his equations. He worked with an English mathematician named Hilda Phoebe Hudson. She was a lecturer at Bryn Mawr at the time, but she was visiting England for about 3 years when she met Ross. Again, I'd like to read from Kucharski. Ross had planned to study a whole range of outbreaks, but his models became more complicated. The mathematics became trickier. He could outline the transmission process, but he couldn't analyze the resulting dynamics. That's when he turned to Hilda Hudson, a lecturer at London's West Ham Technical Institute. Her expertise made it possible to expand the theory of happenings, visualizing the patterns that different models could produce. Some happenings simmered away over time, gradually affecting everyone. Others rose sharply, then fell. Some caused large outbreaks, then settled down into a lower endemic level. There were outbreaks that came in steady waves, rising and falling with the seasons, and outbreaks that occurred sporadically. The rise and fall of epidemics can be explained by the general law of happenings, Ross and Hudson argue. Hudson and Ross wrote 3 papers in 1917, an application of the theory of probabilities to the study of a priori pathognomy, parts 1, 2, and 3. This idea of a priori pathometry actually eventually became mathematical epidemiology. Approximately 10 years after these papers, there were a series of 3 articles written by a Scottish biochemist named William Termack and a Scottish physician named Anderson McKendrick. They presented a model which would explain the spread of infectious diseases in a slightly more general way. Let's give some definitions now. Let's say that our population will be compartmentalized into 3 groups. First, we have S. That is the size of the population who are susceptible to catching a disease, such as malaria. Next, there's I, which is the size of a population who are infected with the disease. And third, there's R. This is the size of the population who have recovered from the disease. The idea of McKernan and Kiernan was that populations should be compartmentalized in 3 boxes. There's the box of those who are susceptible to the disease, a box of those who are currently infected by the disease, and a box of those who were infected but are now recovered from the disease. Kermack and McKendrick made a few assumptions for their model. First, they assumed that everyone fits nicely into exactly one of these 3 populations, and the total population size remains constant. That is, S plus I plus R equals some constant number N. Next, the disease will only spread when the infected interact with the susceptible group. That means the rate of change for the number susceptible depends on the number of susceptible. Well, the more people who are susceptible, the easier the disease can spread, and the number of infected. This rate is negative because those who are susceptible will eventually leave this group and become infected. Next, one cannot recover from the disease unless one was once infected and hence recovered. Similarly, once one is recovered from the disease, we're assuming that they cannot become infected again. This means that the rate of change of the number of recovered depends on the number that are currently infected. This rate is positive because the number of infected will eventually become recovered. And finally, the population of the infected can gain numbers from either the susceptible or lose numbers to the recovered. We're assuming that there is some threshold capital M, such that if the number susceptible S is less than M, then the number of infected decreases because the number of infected are recovering faster than the number of susceptible are contracting the disease. Similarly, if S is greater than M, then the number of infected increases because the susceptible are contracting the disease faster than the infected are recovering. Let's put all of this together using some mathematical symbols. Again, remember that we have three compartments: the number of susceptible, the number of infected, and the number of recovered. According to the rules that we just described, the rate of change for the number susceptible should be proportional to the number of susceptible as well as the number of infected. The rate of change for the number of infected should be dependent upon the quantity S over M minus 1 times the number of infected. The number of recovered should depend upon the number of infected. And finally, the sum of the rates should be 0, because remember that S plus I plus R must remain a constant. Introducing the constants of proportionality, alpha and beta, we then can write dSdt equals negative alpha over n times S times I. We can write dIdt as alpha over n times S times I minus beta times I. dRdt equals beta times I, and S plus I plus R equals N, where M, our threshold, is equal to beta over alpha times capital N. This is called the SIR model. We can simplify things a little bit by introducing instead percentages. Let's let X denote the percentage of those that are susceptible, Y as the percentage of those that are infected, and Z as the percentage of those who've recovered from the disease. This means we can write dxdt as negative alpha times x times y, dydt as alpha times x times y minus beta times y, and dzdt as beta times y. We're going to denote R sub 0 as n over capital M. Remember that n was our total population size, and M was our threshold, which is just equal to alpha divided by beta. We'll give some definitions. The quantity R sub 0 is called the basic reproduction number. This is the expected number of cases directly generated by one case in a population where all individuals are susceptible to infection. If initially we have an X sub 0, remember that this is the initial percentage of those that are susceptible, is greater than 1 over R sub 0, then we say that we have an epidemic. There was a Scottish physician named George MacDonald who had worked with Ronald Ross to create a robust SIR model of malaria. He wrote a book in 1957 on the subject called Epidemiology and Control of Malaria. MacDonald was the first to coin the phrase basic reproduction number, although he used the symbol Z sub 0 instead of the more current R sub 0. We'll come back and talk about all of this in much more detail in a future lesson. Thanks for listening.